Twisted coefficients. And I should say also. Yeah, so I'll be talking about joint work with Oscar Randall-Williams about some homological stability with twisted coefficients. The twisted coefficients are going to be some form of polynomial functors. So I assume you have been talking about polynomial functors the last few days. I'm very sorry I wasn't able to be there and enjoy the polynomial functors with you. I like them too. But let me try to tell you how they show up in homological stability questions, and first say what homological stability is to start with. So I'll have groups, a family of, when one talks about homological stability, it's usually for groups, it could be for spaces, but I'll be talking about groups. They're included into one another, some infinite family. What sort of things do I have? Gn could be the symmetric group. The symmetric group on n letters, if I have a permutation of, say, three elements, I can make it into a bigger permutation by just fixing the next element, and I can keep going. So by so I have inclusions from the permutations on one letter into two. Well, this would be the identity to the identity and so on. But if I have a permutation of some number of things, then I can make it bigger. And another typical example would be the general linear group GLNR over some ring. Well, if I have a matrix, an n by n matrix which is invertible, then I can make it n plus 1 by n plus 1 by adding a 1 in the bottom corner and zeros other places. And this is, again, an invertible matrix. It's just a little bit bigger. Yes. I want them inclusions. I will all the way through want inclusions, otherwise can't talk about them. Okay. Yes. So yeah, so we say these GNs logical stability. When I look at these maps, now I can consider these inclusions as just being maps. I look at them in homology. If these are isomorphism range, when n is sufficiently large. So homology of groups is so that H0 is always just the integers. So this is always an isomorphism on H0. And then you can ask, well, H1 is the abelianization, and you can ask, well, do this map become isomorphism when n is large enough on the abelianization? Well, sometimes it does. And if that's the case, then you can ask the question for H2 and so on. So this is what we call homological stability. And we will also consider it with twisted coefficients for hi, gn, fn. Hi, g, n plus 1, f, n plus 1. So same for this, where now fn is some module with an action of gn. Fn plus 1 is a module with an action of gn plus 1. Of course, they can't be just any module, so I'll have to say for some appropriate effects. So I'll have a family of coefficient systems. Okay, so this is like twisted stability. So this is something that happens reasonably often, which is why I can talk about it. So examples, so. Right. I need for this map to exist, I need that Fn maps to Fn plus 1 in a way which is equivariant with respect to the map Gn to Gn plus 1. Yeah, so that's a minimum I need for this for the question just to make sense, of course. Yeah. So stability is known. So with either constant or some twisted coefficients for groups like symmetric groups, maybe. Symmetric groups, so this is like Nakaoka for constant coefficients and Petli for some twisted coefficients. Braid groups, this is like Arnold constant coefficients, and there are some twisted coefficients by Church and Farb. General linear groups, many people worked on the general linear groups and other types of linear groups. Symplectic groups, some various guys. Quillen is meant to be, to have done the first stability theorems along the lines I will have. But you know, Charney, whatever, Borkman, van der Kallen, I don't know, many people. Automorphisms of free groups. Was generalized to automorphisms of free products of many groups by Eulien and Collinet and Griffin. Let me also mention sort of mapping in mapping class groups of surfaces and three manifolds. Again, this is Hara, Ivanov, Hatcher and myself, a bunch of people. So these are sort of examples of groups where we have known in the last, you know, over the last, these are theorems that, the earlier theorems come from the late 60s, and then the more recent one, very recent. So the goal today, is prove all the above stability theorems, all with the same sorts of coefficients. Okay, so we'll put them all in one box and get the same theorems in one go. Okay, so yeah. And maybe also give you an idea of when you should expect a family, given a family of groups. Maybe you have your favorite family of groups, and give you an idea of when you should expect the things to stabilize. Plan. How do we do this? Here's my plan. We're going to start with our groups, Gn, and from the groups, I'm going to construct a category, not from the group. We'll have a little bit more input than just the groups, but I'll construct a category. From the category, I'll define the coefficient systems that I will use, and I'll also define some spaces Wn with an action of Gn for each n. So I have my family of group. I'll construct a family of spaces, and the sort of, let me write this. Don't know how to deal with these boards. Okay, so here's that's the plan, and the main theorem in a sort of approximative version is if the spaces Wn are highly connected, so their homology is zero, or homotopy groups zero in a range, then stability holds. With certain polynomial coefficients. Okay, so what I'll do now is look at these groups. I'll say what I mean by plus dot dot dot. And then we'll build these categories and talk about the coefficient systems, and I'll make precise statements along those lines. Okay. Okay. So the first thing is I want to think groupoids rather than groups. Groupoids are just categories where all morphisms are invertible. And if I have a bunch of groups, Gn, then I may as well think of them as a groupoid by just saying, well, I take the object to be the natural numbers, and I take the automorphism group. I only have automorphism groups in this category. I have no other morphism, and automorphism group of n is Gn. And maybe I say automorphism of 0 is the identity. Okay. So if I have groups, I can think of them as a groupoid. I haven't done anything yet. But maybe it's a nice point of view if we think of the examples that disappeared below there. In the examples, really we had symmetric groups are automorphisms of finite sets. General linear groups are automorphisms of vector spaces or modules, vector spaces. We had automorphisms of graphs or manifolds. So actually, these examples, they are naturally automorphisms groups. Now they have more structure. No, that's it. That's it. Not yet. That will come there. That's exactly what we'll do. We start with the groups. The groups are just giving a groupoid, which just, you know, we put our groups as automorphism groups, and then we'll build in these other automorphisms. These other morphisms. But to do this, I need to know a little bit more about my group. So we have more structure. Well, I guess. So here's the way these maps show up. So in all these examples, we have two things. One, we have a block sum, gn cross gm to gn plus m. If I have a permutation of two elements and a permutation of three elements, then I put them side by side, and I have a permutation of five elements. Okay. If I have an invertible n by n matrix and an invertible m by m matrix, I put them together like this, and I get an invertible n plus m by n plus m matrix. Okay, so, and you know, for these examples coming from manifolds, the connected sum of manifolds will give you, if you have something which is like an isotopy class of diffeomorphism on one thing, and an isotopy class of diffeomorphism on something else, you can glue them together if they fix something in the boundary. You glue them together, and that's a sort of block sum. But this block sum is not just any block sum. It's braided. So this block sum is called it plus. Plus is what is called braided, often symmetric. So that means that it's like there is an element B and M in G N plus M, which is, you should think of as switching the blocks. So literally, in the case of symmetric groups, it would be the block permutations that takes the one side to the other. It's formally, this is something that has the property such that if I have an element in Gn and an element in Gm, I take the sum, I put them side by side and do this block sum, and then I permute them. I do this twist thing, B and M. It's the same thing as if I first do the twist, B and M, and then I sum them the other way around, G plus F. So this is what braiding is. It's a symmetry. It's called a symmetry if it's symmetric if B square is the identity. So this this structure, this so this G, which is our groupoid, the sum, and this twist is called a braided monoidal groupoid. Any complaints?
How do you keep the track of the fact that there is no maps for injections?
That the maps are injections?
Yes. How is it kept?
I'm just going to require this. I'm just going to plainly ask for this to be the case.
I mean, do you know it? Because you know what the other work is.
I'm gonna only look at sequences of groups where this is. I haven't. No, you're right. I mean, in a minute, I haven't said this now, but yeah, in a braided monoidal group, you don't need these maps to be injections. But in a little bit, you'll see. I'll just say this map is an injection, as an assumption. Yes. If you do surfaces, so that's a good. Let's do a couple of examples. Let's do surfaces. Johannes wants surfaces. Okay. So what's my favorite braided monoidal category? It's the category of surfaces. So I'll do objects are surfaces with at least one boundary component, and morphisms are isotopy classes of diffeomorphisms between surface one and surface two, fixing that particular boundary, one boundary D1. Okay, I have a special boundary component, and I'm looking at things that fix this. Now my sum is going to be, it's really a connected sum, but you can just think of it as gluing along that boundary, or do a pair of pants. Maybe you prefer the pair of pants. It's a pair of pants. So if I have a surface with one boundary component, which is a special, maybe it has other boundaries, I don't care, and some other surface, then I can glue them along a pair of pants, and I have a new surface with one special boundary component, which is this one. If I had a diffeomorphism here and a diffeomorphism there, then because they were assumed to fix this guy, I can extend by the identity, and I have a new diffeomorphism on the whole surface. So that's my connected sum. Now it's braided. What is B? I usually do this B physically. I have my two surfaces. I have one here, one there, and I am the pair of pants. And you know, I do this, and that's the braiding. Okay, a braiding. You know, if I have my groupoid, so G, the braiding, I have one, you know, and in here I have two objects, A and B, which are two surfaces now. My objects don't need to be the natural numbers, which is one thing I wanted to say. They can be any. I can have whatever as objects. My braiding is a map from A plus B to B plus A, okay? And this twist, what you see is, it's a twist that is happening here. There's a it's a half-Dane twist in the pair of pants. So this is the situation where this guy does not square to the identity. When you do this and then you do it again, you get stuck because there's a twist here I can't make with my art. Whereas in most situations, this guy will square. It will be a symmetric thing where the guy squares to the identity. But that's a yeah. So that was one example. I was going to do the simpler examples. You could take finite sets as your objects. These are the objects, and then the homomorphisms are isomorphisms. Isos. Sum is disjoint union, and the braiding, well, if I take A disjoint union B, I have a canonical isomorphism to B disjoint union A. That's one that squares to the identity. So this will give you the automorphism groups of objects here are symmetric groups, right? These will give the symmetric groups. Or you could do objects are finite dimensional vector spaces. Morphisms, again, isos. Sum is sum, direct sum of vector spaces is a happy sum. And if I have V plus W, then again I have a canonical isomorphism to W plus V. Okay. This will give you general linear groups. So these are the sort of braided monoidal groupoids. Is that allowed? I'm in Germany. Nobody. Oh, great. Good. Ah. Yes, I think we're ready for the next. Okay, so these are our, this is what I meant by I started with groups, GN plus something. Plus something was a monoidal structure and a braiding. Okay, then, so from, now we're going to go from group weights to categories. Yes, so there's a, I'll just do a construction of Quillen's bracket construction. Okay, so we start with our group weight, sum, and the grading, and well, we don't care about this for a minute. We just have a group weight. Or really, I mean, this is slightly more general construction, but I'll just use it like this. I'll define a new category, which Quillen denotes G, in case you have seen this before. So this is a category with the objects are the objects of G. So we don't change the objects, but we change the morphisms, and we say, so in here, so hum from A to B in UG is going to be pairs XF, where X is an object in the groupoid, and F is a map in the groupoid from X plus A to B. Okay, so I used to only have isomorphisms. Now I'm allowing maps. I'm going to introduce maps from sort of smaller objects, because I'm putting a map if I can sum and get something isomorphic. But these are equivalent classes. I'm not going to take this one. I'm only going to take X up to isomorphisms. So it'll be equivalent to if I have an X prime plus A and an F prime, and I have you know, a phi plus the identity on A, which is an isomorphism, and this diagram commutes, then we'll say that XF is equal to X prime F prime. Okay, so we are introducing sort of increasing morphisms by choosing an isomorphism class of complement. We don't choose the complement, but we choose it as up to isomorphisms. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So example. yeah. So example. If we started with finite sets, if G was finite sets plus isomorphisms, then you know what are we doing? We're looking at, you know, a new map from A. You know, we're looking at maps of the form like this, right? We have X disjoint union A, isomorphism to B up to a choice of this guy, the isomorphism class of this guy. This means I'm really only, this is going to be an injection from A to B. So this, you know, these guys will be just injections A into B. And so this is UG is finite sets plus injections, the category called, usually called Fi. On the other hand, if we start with vector spaces, G is vector spaces, and you know they are isomorphisms, then what are we looking at? We're looking at, you know, X, okay, whatever, X plus V to W, an isomorphism, up to a choice of, you know, up to changing this one by an isomorphism here, right? Up to changing this. But this means that, well, I have an injective isomorphism, an injective homomorphism from V. So V is an injects into W, but I'm choosing a complement. I'm not choosing it as with a basis, but I'm choosing as a space plus a choice of complement as a subspace. So these are the split injections. So UG is vector spaces plus split injections. And by split, I mean split it, right? Where I have, if you like, where I actually have chosen a splitting. Okay. Maybe we keep the plan for a little bit. And okay, so what I want to say now for a second is, well, it's a very particular construction. So, you know, I haven't used, when I defining this, you can do this for any groupoid, but we will do this for particular types of groupoids, and so we'll get particular types of categories. I mean, it is a particular type of category to start with, but we know even more about the groupoid, so we'll know more about the category. So I'll just summarize the sort of things that happen when you do this. So first, we have four. So zero, which is the unit in G, is initial in UG. If you look at, you know, if you take a map from zero to some A. Well, it will have only one possible complement, which is A, or something isomorphic to A. But we're doing this up to the isomorphism of the complement, so there's only one possible morphism. Okay, so we've made zero initial. The other thing that happens is, when we know that if G is braided monoidal, which we want to assume, then that will imply that UG is what I call pre-braided monoidal. So it will be monoidal, so there is a well-defined sum in C, but it's not quite a braided monoidal category. It has a weaker, it has an underlying braided groupoid, but it has a weaker version of the braiding endomorphism. It only has the relation that says B, braiding AB, of, if I look at the particular types, so braiding is a, you know, you apply your braiding, we had this braided relation said, if I have two morphisms, which used to be just isomorphisms, I do my two guys, and then I do the braiding, it's the same as if I first do the braiding and then do my two guys in the other order. And so this will happen on isomorphisms, but on general morphisms, you only have such a relation if you start with the identity on A plus the unique morphism from 0 to B. Then this is the B plus the identity on A, where this is the unique morphism from zero to B. So we only have a braided-like relation on a very particular types of type of morphisms. If the group OID is symmetric, then this funny phenomenon doesn't happen, and you get a symmetric monoidal category. So this is something I guess Aurélien and Christine know well. Yes. So I should say the sort of the types of categories that show up are things Aurélien and Christine have studied in while looking at the stable homology of certain groups with twisted coefficients. So some of what I say overlaps with things they have done. So we're creating a category that will, you know, if we start with a braided monoidal group OID, we'll get a monoidal category with some weak form of braiding. And now, under, you know, assuming this braided monoidal, that the group OID was braided monoidal, if we also say three, if G satisfies cancellation, G satisfies cancellation, so cancellation in the group OID, this is like, you know, if A plus B is isomorphic to A prime plus B, that implies A isomorphic to A prime. This is equivalent to saying that in UG, if we look at HOM from, so in UG from A to B, which are not the same A's and B's, this has an action of the automorphism group of B by post-composition. So I can look at my HOM set from A to B as an action of automorphism of B. This will be transitive. The reason these things are equivalent is because the cancellation will say that complements are isomorphic, and the fact that complements are isomorphic will give this transitivity. And then, so this is something I'll bit in the way. Let me call this property H1. The fourth thing is if, and here's this thing people asked about before, if I know that the automorphism group of A includes into the automorphism group of A plus B, so when I take F to F plus the identity on B, okay, so I'm saying if this is true, I don't know how to otherwise do this, then in UG, then OAuth in UG of A includes in OAuth in UG of A plus B under the same map with image what I call fix B. So what is fix B? In I can again look at the map. I have a special map from B to A plus B, which is just iota A plus identity on B. Okay, so I have a zero is initial, so I can just map. I have my favorite map from B to A plus B. And to be in fix B, so these are the automorphisms that fix this map. This is the set of phi in the automorphism group such that phi of iota A plus B equals iota A plus B. Okay? So this is a property I want to call H2. Okay, so when we start with, these are the things we want to start with, right? We want to start with a braided monoidal group OID satisfying this inclusion. We will get a very particular type of category. C plus zero with, so monoidal with zero initial plus this H1 and H2 equal what I call a homogeneous. And in what I'll do actually always works for these sorts of categories. In practice, most of the time there will be this particular UG. So it's a good, if you think a family of group, you can always construct such a category this way. Ah, always. There's a slightly strange thing that the stability with constant coefficient doesn't need the pre-Bradyness. I don't know why, but otherwise pre-Bradyness would be necessary. So there's one hypothesis. I mean, we've talked a lot about the monoidal structure, which is this block sum we have, and this braiding, and then I said, well, we assume also these inclusions, and then I passed over this other hypothesis, which was in number three there, is that we have cancellation. So cancellation is actually not as bad a property as one may think at first. If your groupoid does not satisfy cancellation, you can make it satisfy cancellation. How do you make it satisfy cancellation? Well, you take, if plus B isomorphic to A prime plus B prime plus B does not imply A prime isomorphic to A, well, then make it not isomorphic, right? You suppose your groupoid is on the objects generated by a bunch of objects, you can take the free monoid on the objects, and hey, it satisfies cancellation by definition. It's not as silly an idea as it may first look like. I mean, in the context of what we are trying to do, we're trying to look at the homology of the automorphism groups. The automorphism groups, when I do that, are not changed. I'm just doing something on the objects. I'm talking about the same groups as I used to. What I'm doing is I'm fixing the category, but the category is what is going to encode, it's still here. The category will tell me about the coefficient systems and about certain spaces. And I'm just correcting to get the right, this procedure actually corrects so that the things we construct are the correct things. So it's not a, yeah. Some? Hmm? Hmm? Yeah. Yeah, so I got a lot in trouble with Oscar doesn't like this sort of making it free, because naturally there are examples where, you don't have cancellation on the nose, like, in modules or in certain high dimensional manifolds, you won't have cancellation, but you will have cancellation as long as you know that B is big enough in an appropriate way. So this is a way, so one can reformulate all that I say by saying, well, you only have cancellation locally for appropriate A's and B's, and then you will only have this property for appropriate A's and B's, but which will also be good enough. So you don't have to do this trick of taking the free monoid on the object. You can also, if you have cancellation from, in a certain direction, you can also do something like that. It's not always. I mean, if you think of modules and rings, you would be sort of, we have a nice category of modules and rings, and you would be suddenly taking a strange free thing on objects, which may not be so natural. Yeah. Anyway, cancellation is not an issue, which is why I sort of skipped over it. That's all I wanted to say. Okay. So we went from groupoids, groups here, and under the assumptions we liked for our examples, we constructed a certain type of category. And now I want to tell you about the, I'll first tell you about space. So from categories, I want to construct these spaces. So this is easy. So I have, you know, C plus 0, and again you can think C favorite category of groups, and for each So I have to go back to my groups. So I wanna just start from one of these categories, and I wanna consider slightly more general groups than I was doing before. What I'll do is fix objects A and X, objects of C, and I will consider Gn is going to be the group of automorphisms of A plus X plus n times. So I start with some place A in my category, and I'm going to do plus X, plus X, plus X, plus X. Okay? So that's my Gn. So I have a natural map to Gn plus 1, which is aut A plus X plus N plus 1 by doing plus X, doing plus adding the object X and on morphisms adding the identity is a functor in my category. So in particular, it will induce such a map. Okay? So those are the sort of the families of groups I want to look at. And again, you know, we have assumed these are inclusions. This is part of my my assumption there, that if I take the automorphism of something and I add the identity, then this is an inclusion. Okay. So now one for each n, I had to define a space. For each n, I wanted a space X Wn with Gn acting on it. So Wn is going to be a semi-simplicial set which P simplices, Wnp is just Hom in Ug from X to the P plus 1 to A plus X. This is my set of P simplices. And then a semi-simplicial set has face maps. It doesn't have degeneracies. It just has face maps. And the face map, so I have to give you Di to Wn P minus 1. But this is just going to be, so this is Hom, same thing, but from X to the P. And this is going to be given by a map here the other way around, that is just inserting using my initial morphism at the ice spot. So this is the map X to the I plus iota X, I input an X plus X to the P minus I. Okay? So I have natural such maps. This is a simplicial, semi-simplicial set. And it comes with an action of Gn simply by post-composition. Gn is the automorphism group of this, so I can just post-compose by post-composition. And that's of course that's compatible with the face maps, which are happening in the. So it is in the sense that if I start with, for example, if I want to do symmetric groups, I start with the groupoid of finite sets and isomorphisms. I make my category. I take A to be 0, and I take X to be 1. Same for GLN. But if you get into things like manifolds, then there are many, you know, these are not naturally groupoids just on one thing. So I might want to talk about stability of, you know, surfaces with respect to genus. And maybe I start with a punctured disk, and then I stabilize with genus. Or I start with a surface of a certain genus, and I stabilize with punctures. So then I could, you know, I could A could be some surface, and then I choose my X to be an interesting stabilization, which is why. It's more general. Okay. So I'm ready for my first precise statement, which is, let me hide this for a second, write the statement, and I show you show the whole thing again. So here's the first precise statement. So if I start, we see a homogeneous category, so one of these things here. So for example, one of these UG, for G, a braided monoidal grouproids. And if WN is N minus 2 over K connected for some K bigger or equal to 2, and then for all N, right? For all N, I want such a connectivity with a fixed K, which is at least 2, then stability with constant coefficient holds. Hi gn z to hi gn plus 1 z is an isomorphism whenever I is smaller than n minus 1 over k. Let's put this up. Okay, so this is a first theorem of this form. If my spaces are, so, I mean, it's enough to know that the homology, I usually say connected, but I mean, acyclic, it would be good enough to know that the homology is zero in this range, up to a certain dimension, then I always have stability with constant coefficients. So I don't have to do.
And it's not true for k equals 1?
No, not in general. No. Take the symmetric groups, we know that stability is not true with slope 1. So this k is called the slope. So in some cases, one knows a better slope than this. But you know, if I have to make a general statement that always holds in this situation, I know that 2 is the best. Yeah. Significantly, two-third is two-third better than the two-third is the. Yeah, the mapping class group, two-thirds. And then, you know, under some, sometimes one has slope 1 under very, you know, under specific assumptions, but it doesn't often happen. Martin agrees. But like, yeah, I mean, really, slope 2 is the most common, and you know, I must say, I don't. It's not often that you get a worse slope than 2 in the connectivity. But I guess non-orientable mapping class groups, I guess, is a place where the connectivity of the complex actually kicks in and gives you a K which is bigger. Yes, that's true. That's true. You can do that. Okay. Yes. So we've done stability with constant coefficients modulo that I have said nothing about why this holds. But let me rather keep going and talk about coefficient systems. So I at last come to some polynomial something. Okay, so coefficient systems. So we always have this category. Again, I think, you know, U of your groupoid. And then we look at F at functors, our coefficient systems, they're going to be functors from the category to say Z module. So if I have such a functor, what do I have? I have F. I can look at I wanted my coefficient systems, I wanted an Fn. For each n, I wanted an Fn and a Gn, and then I should have a compatibility with Fn plus 1 and Gn plus 1. So what is Fn? Fn is just F of A plus X plus n, and this admits an action of Gn, which was just the automorphism group of this object, just because F is a functor. Okay, and also, well, what is Fn plus 1? Well, it's F of A plus X plus N plus 1. And so I have my map again plus X plus the identity on X, which here I just take the map plus X. This is a map. It gives me a map on the, because F is a functor, and it's going to be compatible with the map from Gn to Gn plus 1, because that map was also doing plus X. Okay, so just the fact that I have a functor gives me that it makes sense to talk about homology of Gn, the map from Hn Gn to Hn Hi Gn plus 1 F n plus 1. This map, there exists such a map. So I can ask the question whether this map is an isomorphism. Okay, so when is it going to be an isomorphism? We say F is of degree R at N. If when I look at the map, I can look at the functor F, and I can look at F of the same thing plus X. So either I apply my functor X, or I look at the sort of shifted functor. I don't know how, I assume this has shown up before this week. You can look at the kernel of this. This is again a functor. And I want this to be 0. It's a functor. I can apply it at A plus X plus N. And I want this to be 0 when n is bigger or equal to my big N. So from a certain place, I want my kernel to be 0. And the co-kernel of the same map, I want it to be of degree R minus 1 at the same N. So this is sort of, because this is the more one way to formulate polynomiality of functors, to look at these co-kernels. Here I also need to know that the kernel is trivial. Often when one looks at, if one looks at functors from categories that where zero is not just initial but also terminal, then these maps will be split, and so they will automatically be injective. But I'm looking at categories where zero is definitely not terminal. It's always just initial. So I have to put this as an extra condition. Degree zero. Sorry. Where degree minus 1 at n means zero after n, right? Do I have to say? Yeah, means f of a plus x n is 0, n bigger or equal to n. Okay? And I really should have said, for the objects a and x, right? I mean, I'm really interested in this polynomial degree with respect to these two guys. Yes?
So you need both conditions,
so
it's not that one
applies
here?
No, I need both conditions, yeah. This and. I mean, these two things, yeah. Okay, so these are my polynomial functors. Examples, constant functors are of degree polynomial, of degree zero. If your constant, your kernel is zero and your co-kernel is zero, and zero is, but they could also be just constant from a certain n onwards. That would also be, that would fit in here. Yeah, you can take, you can take various. You can take all sorts of things. I mean, typically higher degree, I assume, these things have shown up this week. I mean, you could take, some like the adjoint representation of the general linear groups and then take tensor powers of it or something like that to get a higher degree coefficient, something like this, right? The adjoint representation of GLN, so, n by n matrices. And then maybe you take tensor powers of this, and then you take GLN adjoint action. This would be degree at zero. On R to the n, I would think that was degree one. I think, yes. Complaints? All n, yes. Where? This is n is zero. So and n is zero. So if you have, this is, why did we want these n's? Is because if you take, so this is. Vespa, so FI finitely generated FI modules fits in here. Degree, finite degree at some n, so a finitely generated FI module. So FI was this category of finite sets and injections. So you're looking at functors from finite sets and injections. They're finitely generated if there's finitely many. How do you formulate this? You need finite. There's only one functor. So that only finite, you can pick finitely many things in there, so that there's only one functor that extend that. You extend this to a functor, but in only, there's only that functor that extends it to a functor. I'm not saying this very well. There's a well-defined notion of finitely generated, which I'm screwing up, and these guys will have kernel finitely generated, but not necessarily zero. The kernel in the kernel, the maps in the kernel are always always zero. So a finitely generated kernel will mean a kernel that is non-zero at finitely many places. And so we will know, it will only satisfy this from a certain n onwards. The zeroness will only be. There will be functors showing up that are just, they're non-zero finitely many places, and then they're zero. I need them. I need the kernel to be zero. So I need. That's why this condition is there.
Is there something special about X in general? So when I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking,
three boards back. We pick an X. Okay, sorry. So in many examples, if your groupoid has objects, in many examples, the objects of the groupoid n of the category are going to be the natural numbers. And then you take a0, the most natural thing to do is a0 and x is 1. Yeah, so that's the you know, the, so general linear groups, symmetric groups, these things, the typical examples would be of this form. But really, one should think, you know, you could stabilize, you know, X raises the dimension, exactly. That's a good way to think about it. Yes? Okay, so you can guess my next line. So is of course that the same theorem holds, but I need my bounds. So here I assume this pre-braidedness head anyway, pre-braided homogeneous category, and I have my functor f from C to Z modules, which is of degree R at n. And again, we take Gn to be the automorphism group of A plus X plus n for some A and X, and we take Fn to be the value of f at a plus x plus n, then, and we assume this Wn is n minus 2 over k connected, all n, sum k greater or equal to 2, and then stability holds, then hi gn fn to h Fn plus 1, it's an idle, I smaller or equal to n minus k over k minus r, and, you know, n, then, you know, for n bigger or equal to n, I have to assume that I'm past plus 1, n plus 1, I have this. And in fact, I smaller or equal to n minus r minus k over k if f was split as a functor. So if not only I had the kernel that was zero, but I actually had a splitting of functors up there, then the bound improves. Is that better? Yes. So yeah, the constant coefficient is so. This, if I had written the subjectivity bounds, they would be the same. But the proof, one can do the proof in the constant coefficient case in a slightly better way. That one gets a slightly better bound. If k was, so k is k, right? R would be zero, so r would not be there. So this, the one I gave there is slightly better. The constant. Yes. Yeah, so the proof, you know, when you have to do the general proof, you have to do a relative proof. You have to do this for the relative groups. And so you get a, you know, you get a relative group being zero. And so which means that the injectivity bound would be plus 1 or minus 1. Whereas if you don't do a relative group, then you can get a slightly better small difference. But maybe I, so can do more. This also works. Okay, same works with F from C to Z G infinity abelian modules. What is this? So let me, I can give you, I want to give you a slightly more general statement, which is, so we had this, we started with a, we had a functors to Z modules, now we could instead go to G infinity modules. So G infinity is the limit of these groups, the union of the GNs. G infinity abelianized, this is H1 of G infinity. It's also H1 of Gn whenever n is large enough, I think k plus 1, because stability, if I know stability, okay? So it's the abelianization, as, you know, it's what they become. In any case, I always have a map from Gn to G infinity, and hence also to its abelianization. So a G infinity abelian module, so if I land in, for such functors, when I take Fn, which was this F of A plus X plus N, it has a Gn action because it's a, F is a functor, the same as we had so we have been using so far, but it also has a G infinity abelian action because I land in, this is a G infinity abelian module, okay, and hence a Gn, another Gn action, right, by just mapping Gn to G infinity abelian. So you can write, you know, this, you know, the theorem holds for Fn with this diagonal action and worst bounds. And in particular, k has to be at least 3. The two axiom commutes because it's a functor into G infinity abelian modules. Yes. So you don't get quite as the ranges are worse, and the and you have to, even if you have a connectivity bound, you know, where's the, and it's gone. It's here. So you can do the same thing, but you know, even if you have a connectivity bound with a k is equal to 2, your conclusion will be with a k is equal to 3, and some bounds. So this is an example. You can take a constant functor Z G infinity abelian, for example, or maybe you could take or an old functor as we had before, tensor with Z G infinity abelian. Make it such a guy. So this what a corollary of this theorem is, so corollary is Hi T prime N Fn to Hi G prime N plus 1 F N plus 1 also stabilizes for G prime N in sign G and the commutator subgroup. This is by Shapiro's lemma. So the same methods give you also homological stability for things like alternating groups, also with twisted coefficients, and SLNR in many cases and things like that. So, I don't know. So, do I say a word about the proof, or do you, are you guys too tired? Maybe I stop for questions, and then someone, if someone really wants to hear, then I say, I stop. I don't know, I haven't thought about that. Maybe they are always, maybe they are always perfect. They are always perfect.
Always?
Yes. In this setup. Yes, good point. I mean, you know, there are, as I was saying, you know, like, take a bad ring and take this, you know, split, you know, the category that would be the correct one, except that it's a bad ring and, you know, cancellation doesn't quite hold. It only holds when you have enough copies of the ring hanging around. So, so you know, of that type, there are examples, but otherwise, otherwise, I don't know. Yeah, so modulo bottom phenomena, I don't know. Yeah.
You use a very semi-simple shell set, or a regular simple shell set that had only base maps, but no generics maps. Is that standard terminology?
It's the new, it's the young people's standard terminology. maybe very old people may complain that in the old days.
Exactly.
So, but you're not that, that you don't classify, you know, you know, you're not in that category.
Yeah,
so.
Okay.
Huh? In the very old days, yes, semi-simplicial sets used to be called semi-simplicial set, but this is so long ago that we allowed to change the terminology.
No, in the very old days, semi-simplicial set was also
okay. Oh, in the same sense?
Yes.
Oh. Oh, okay, okay, okay. Yes, very good. Yes?
In your study, you can make social like enterprise stories, personal social. Can you get a stability statement for this kind of more as enterprise story constructed
What? So you can.
So, I mean, as you said, the first of all, are perfect.
You can always do that, yeah. Yeah, so it's. I mean, what you get, if you do the like this, the sort of setup we are in are compatible with the group completion setup, so that the homology of the stable group will be the group completion of, you know, will be of the plus construction of the infinite guy. So we can always do the plus construction, and we can, so you know, so there is also a computation of it, also comes with a computation of the stable thing as being that. I don't know if that's what you. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have a suspicion whether you could the statement for connectivity set is also a formal consequence? Of course not in the way you state it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm still looking for an example of something which is not highly connected. So I don't know an example where this simplicial complex is not highly connected. So this is the first suspicion I have. That. So here's another funny fact. It's the connectivity, which you may know, this is something Oscar told me. So the connectivity implies the cancellation. The fact that the semi-simplicial set is connected implies that this cancellation property or this sort of first axiom in these homogeneous categories. So so the connectivity is already related to the assumptions, but this is like the very bottom thing, right? And it's only related. In practice, you know, when you do things like symmetric groups, the connectivity is not so bad to prove. But general linear groups, I mean, I know a proof, but it's not easy. And you know, looking at examples, we see patterns in the proofs. Like there are things that show up. There are types of examples where I want to say it's quite automatic. Like, but I don't yet see the general proof of connectivity. I mean, that's I don't know. But yeah, I mean, this is sort of, I definitely wonder about that. I don't know. I don't know if that in general can help. I know in some cases it helps, but I don't know if there's a general...